Good evening, TCC, and welcome to our Good Friday service. Why do we call it good? What could be good about this day? If that's a question you've asked, you're on the right track, for tonight is a night of paradox, of holding things that appear contradictory together. Tonight we hold God's love together with punishment and justice. We hold God's goodness together with sin and death. We hold suffering with salvation. As Pastor Tom said, our script for Holy Week comes from Isaiah, who tells us what kind of Savior we ought to expect. Isaiah writes, "He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem." Isaiah says that mankind would reject and despise the one he sent. Have you rejected Jesus? Have you ever been ashamed of your faith? If so, you are welcome here tonight. Are you burdened by suffering, familiar with pain? If so, Jesus welcomes you here tonight. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Do you hold guilt or shame because of past mistakes? If so, you are welcome here tonight. Do you continue to struggle with sin? If so, you too are welcome here tonight, for you are just like all of us. Because Isaiah writes, "We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." So I invite you to pour out your heart to God tonight by acknowledging the way that you have gone astray and turning to him for forgiveness, salvation, and life. Let's worship God.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on the cursed tree. My mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on the cursed
Exodus 32, verse 7 to 10. And the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, for your people whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way that I commanded them. They have made for themselves a golden calf, and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it, and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.' And the Lord said to Moses, 'I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, in order that I make a great nation of you.'"
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold a man upon a sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer. This I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
Today's second reading is from Luke chapter 23, verse 4, and verses 13 to 23. Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no guilt in this man." Pilate then called together the chief priests and the rulers and the people and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was misleading the people. And after examining him before you, behold, I did not find this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither did Herod, for he sent him back to us. Look, nothing deserving death has been done by him. I will therefore punish and release him. But they all cried out together, Away with this man, and release to us Barabbas, a man who had been thrown into prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Pilate addressed them once more, desiring to release Jesus. But they kept shouting, Crucify, crucify him. A third time he said to them, Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no guilt deserving death. I will therefore punish and release him. But they were urgent, demanding with loud cries that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed.
Are pierced for one like me. Thy feet were nailed upon the tree to trample down our sin. Thy hand stretched out for all to see to take thy murders in. Voice so well in shock holds back its beams. Hear how he groans while nature shakes and all earth's strong pillars bend. The temple's veil in sunder breaks, the solid marbles rend. His sacred head, the God of angels dies. But soon he'll break death's envious chain and in full glory shine. O Lamb of God, was ever pain, was ever love like thine.
Hosanna, glory be to our. 23, verses 32 through 41. Two others who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments. And the people stood by, watching. But the rulers scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself. If he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine, and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him: "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we, indeed, justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong."
So guilt, we know it all too well. We know it best probably as that nauseating feeling that makes our stomach roll when we have the knowledge that we have hurt someone in relationship. And it's that nagging feeling that is kind of like an alarm in our system that goes off, kind of like a car alarm, that annoying sound, you can't wait for it to be shut off. We know the feeling of guilt. In fact, we all know it when someone says to you, especially a superior, "Oh, I want to talk to you." First thing you think of, what did I do wrong? At least that's what I think. So guilt has a lot of power over us. Guilt holds us down emotionally. It holds us down physically. And the big question really that is before us as we're thinking of guilt is it true guilt or is it false guilt? There's a lot of false guilt that is out there. And so because we can't differentiate between true guilt and false guilt, we find ways to alleviate guilt, period, whether it's true or false. We blame others. We try to work it off. We do rational things to make it go away. And so we always are trying to find a way to alleviate guilt. There's green guilt. There's guilt for not saving enough money. There's guilt for saving too much money. There's guilt on parents because they let their children watch too much screen time. And so we're in a world where guilt is before us. And the news for us this Good Friday is that Good Friday causes us to take a look at and face true guilt. So what does true guilt look like? What does true guilt look like? Well, true guilt looks like a cross. And true guilt looks like a calf. But let's first begin this Good Friday with the cross. Good Friday confronts us with true guilt. And let's look at the cross. In Luke 23, we have an amazing picture, and the verses that were read for us highlight it. We have two criminals, and that's what I want to highlight, are the two criminals, and they have what I'm calling a jaw-dropping cross-side conversation. Criminal number one, verse 39, this is what he says. "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." It's all we hear from criminal number one. This is the only time he speaks. And we hear in that statement the hardened nature of this criminal. And he's asking for salvation, but he's doing it tongue-in-cheek because he doesn't really believe that he needs it. He's actually mocking God's mercy. He's actually rejecting divine assistance, and it's echoed in his very words. Are you not the Christ? Save yourself. And this is remarkable, I think, after hearing what Jesus himself said, hanging right next to him on the cross, in verse 34. Jesus said this, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." All the more, criminal number one and his statement and his rejection of divine assistance makes no sense. And so he's a picture, this criminal number one is a picture of staunch resistance, but at a moment of great weakness. Even after seeing mercy personified in Jesus and hearing mercy personified in the statement, "Father, forgive them, they know not what they do," he is a hardened criminal. That's what guilt looks like at the cross. It's ugly, and criminal number one does the unthinkable. But then we have another criminal at the cross, and I'm calling him criminal number two. And these verses are also just as alarming in another way as verse 39. He is the softened criminal, and he actually rebukes criminal number one. The other rebuked him, saying this, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed just, for we are receiving our due reward of our deeds. But this man," he says, "has done nothing wrong." And so the probing question in verse 40, "Do you fear God?" Well, that's the least that the criminal number one could do, would be to fear God at his moment of need and moment of desperation. But what he really needs is fearing God, that is, fearing the sentence of death that comes from breaking God's law, not Roman law. And so, fearing God would be a good thing for him. And so, criminal number two has an incisive and a probing question. The other statements that are made by criminal number two, very aware that the law has been broken, very aware that death is required because of it, and very aware that he is deserving death and that it is reality. And you see that reality by the statement of contrast that he makes about Jesus. This man has done no wrong. And so criminal number two is having a revelation, and albeit he's having a revelation at the last moment, but it's a revelation nonetheless. True guilt then acknowledges wrongdoing at the time of one's greatest need. And so criminal number two is realizing he needs divine assistance. And so basically then we have true guilt is acknowledging, from criminal number two, acknowledging wrongdoing, awareness that he is desperate for the mercy of God. And so he believes then that Jesus is the way to that, because this is a statement that he says. Jesus, in verse 42, he says, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." That's another way of saying, "Have mercy on me." It's another way of saying, "I believe you." It's another way, it's very similar language to what happened back in Exodus when God heard their cries. He remembered his covenant when he heard the cries of his people. So now he's hearing this cry, and this criminal is saying, "Jesus, remember me." In other words, not a cognitive thing, Jesus, but do something about my state. Do something about this condition. And so he asks Jesus for deliverance. He asks him for deliverance right on the spot. And what is Jesus' response? Is today, he says in verse 43, "You will be with me in paradise." In other words, mercy and salvation is immediate. No more delays. He has immediate access to it. In fact, the reality of that is God, Jesus says to him, today you will be with me in paradise. In other words, he is going to go God's way after all. Even though his whole life he hadn't gone God's way, now he is actually going God's way. And so what we have then in these two criminals is guilt is a fact on two accounts, in the human court and in the divine court. Criminal number two, he has dealt with true guilt. And that's why there is the account of these two criminals. But that is not the only picture of guilt. The cross is not the only picture of guilt, but the calf is also a picture of guilt. Let's look at this scripture that was read earlier. In Exodus 32, we have guilt and what it looks like yet again. And it is in the form of a golden calf. And so the calf in Exodus 32 through 34 is a powerful story. And the events leading up to the calf paint yet another picture of resistance. They do in the wilderness with the calf the unthinkable, just like the criminal number one does at the cross. They make a calf, they sacrifice to it, and they not only do they do the unthinkable in making the calf, but they say the unthinkable. Behold your gods who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. And so God exposes this problem to Moses, and this is what he says: go down, because the people whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, they've corrupted themselves. And how do they do it? So there's this internal corruption. And the way they did it is they turned aside quickly from God's way, the way. The Ten Commandments that they were waiting for Moses to have when he came down the mountain. The way that they signed on the dotted line. The ink was not yet even dry on the covenantal agreement, and they quickly turned aside. And so there's this internal corruption that is exposed. The graven image is a visual of a graver problem, an internal heart problem. In fact, verse 9 is God's verdict of this event. Verse 9 says this: I have seen this people, and it is stiff-necked. Now therefore let me alone, that my wrath might be burning against them. The idea of being stiff-necked, the whole concept of stiff-necked is a metaphor. And it comes from this idea of animal husbandry. When a rope was placed over an animal and the animal rejected going in that direction, the back and the neck and the shoulders of that animal would stiffen and not move. And so the apt imagery, the apt metaphor, is to be stiff-necked. In other words, resistant to movement in a certain direction. And so then that's what God says about his people. And because they go their own way, they go their own way quickly, they display this posture of being stiff-necked. They are guilty then of going their way and not God's way. They've transgressed the moral code that they agreed to. And by the way, this is very important. Guilt is highly relational, because God did not give a moral code only to his people, but he gave them himself. And so guilt then is highly relational. So building this thing, building the calf, is really that first moment, that concrete illustration in the life of God's people to show us what it looks like to really reject and resist the way of God, like criminal number one. So it's a picture of staunch resistance, not a pretty picture. Guilt is a fact. It is not a feeling. In fact, Stephen, in the book of Acts, he's the first martyr. He's the first deacon as the church gets underway. Not long, actually, after the events of the cross, Stephen actually connects the cross to the calf, because he says that the people who, in Acts chapter 7, he says that the people who betrayed and murdered Jesus have a character trait just like those back in the wilderness. They are stiff-necked. They resist the things of God and go their way. And so literally What do we have then? From the calf to the cross, we have this undeniable fact of ongoing and escalating guilt and the inability for people to admit their guilt. One biblical writer says that their guilt was higher than the heavens. And so this ongoing resistance, this ongoing desire to go their way and not God's way, not listening to his moral code, makes them liable to death. Guilt looks like a cross. Guilt looks like a calf. But you say, oh, well, no, hold on. I didn't build that calf. I wasn't at that cross saying, crucify him, crucify him. I'm not criminal number one. I've done nothing. Well, the stiff-necked posture and this guilty verdict that's exposed by the calf, by the cross, by criminal number one, and by all the crowds at the cross actually represents all of humankind. It represents all of humanity. Because from the calf to the cross, all we, says Isaiah, are like another kind of animal, a sheep. And we've all gone astray, and we've all gone our own way. Jesus says it too. Jesus says, and said it then, and he continues to say it now, I am the way. But we resist the way. While we were stiff-necked, hardened criminals, Christ died for us. And while we lie, and while we bear false witness, while we do and perform hate crimes, while we do things that fail the moral code, Christ died for us. We have a record of debt because of the guilt that is stacked up in our lives. We have a record of ongoing and escalating guilt. These are the facts of the case on Good Friday. And all of this, of course, has consequences. What are then the consequences for stiff-necked behavior and a guilty verdict? What's the consequence for this inward corruption that produces an ugly cross and an ugly calf? Well, it's the conditions are ripe, if you will, for divine justice to emerge. Because clearly, we know, wages for sin does equal death. And so the consequences then for being stiff-necked, the consequences for the guilty verdict becomes the basis then for divine justice to emerge. It becomes the basis for divine abandonment, complete separation from the living God. Our deep-seated character flaw and our guilt requires a mediator to mediate the rift in the relationship. And so the condition, our condition, becomes the basis for divine mercy as well. So it becomes the basis for divine justice, divine separation, and divine mercy. But it also becomes a condition for a revelation of God's character. And that is what leads us to the cross. Because the cross is the cure for the condition. The cross is the place where God's justice and his mercy collide with your stiff neck and mine. It's the place where the needed mediation takes place between a holy God and stiff necks because of Jesus' sacrifice. As Jesus is crying out in Luke 23, 34, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The conditions for divine mercy are met in that forgiveness. And as Jesus cries out, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit, the conditions for divine justice are met in his death. And so the unthinkable happens at the cross. And here is what I want you to hear. God meets our staunch resistance with assistance. what happens at the cross is unthinkable. Sit with that for a moment. And so the cross then, the cross is the cure for the stiff-necked, guilty verdict. And Jesus then is crying out to God for divine justice at this moment. And he's doing it for people who have true guilt. He's doing it for people who deserve death. And so the good news of Good Friday is this, is that the cross alleviates true guilt, because guilt is not a feeling, but it is a fact. And unlike that annoying car alarm that goes off and we can turn it off, we cannot and do not have the ability to turn off our own guilt. Only the cross can alleviate that guilt. Five times in Luke's account of the Passion, we are told that Jesus is not guilty, not deserving of death, and even the criminal says it. He has done nothing wrong. Because of the cross alleviating guilt, those declarations become ours. We have done nothing wrong. We have done nothing deserving death. And so the cross is our reminder to admit guilt and to actually be like criminal number two, to fear God and to be able to warn others against being like criminal number one. Now, think about this for a moment. If you're like me, admitting guilt is not easy. In fact, I get all tense. If you're not able to admit guilt, think of your posture. You might be getting all tensed and stiff-necked. True guilt, then, acknowledges wrongdoing. And as a result, feelings come all right, but they're not feelings of guilt. You know what the feelings are? They are feelings of remorse, followed by a lifestyle change. And so the cross alleviates our guilt. It reminds us to admit guilt and to fear God and not ignore it. And so not to ignore this healthy, true alarm that goes off when we cross God's moral code is problematic. So we have to listen to the healthy alarm that does go off in our hearts and in our lives. And so at the cross, then, we have the cure for our stiff neck condition. We have the cure for our ongoing, escalating, and our inability to admit guilt, because the cross is our get out of jail free card. Jesus bails us out of our death sentence. And listen to what Colossians 2 says. I love this verse when I think of Good Friday. This is what God does with true guilt deserving of death. Colossians 2:14 says, he canceled the bond which stood against us with its legal demands, and this, he nailed it to the cross. Wow. When Jesus was nailed to the cross, it appeased God's wrath. He was the offended party in the relationship, and we don't have to fear wrath anymore because Jesus received the wrath. God vented his anger for our unholiness on Jesus. And so God's forgiveness at the cross deals with true guilt. And true guilt is a heavy, weighty matter that cannot be borne on our own. And like the song says, our sins, not in part, but the whole, are nailed to the cross. And the other line that comes right after that, and we bear it no more. We can't bear it, and so he bears it for us. And so the cure then for our condition, the cure for our stiff-neckedness comes from the cross. It's God's initiative to deal with your stiff neck and mine. And so let's ask ourselves this question. Are you guilty today? Maybe you need to hear this news. But let's think about this in another way. The cross is God's initiative to deal with our guilt, yes, one time. But here's the best news. Not just one-time offenses, but repeat customers. And I don't know about you, but I'm a repeat customer. If you're under the weight of sin, if you're feeling the effects of Good Friday, then you're feeling the effects of true guilt. And that is a great place to be. Do you have a little moral alarm ringing in your heart right now because of a transgression that you have crossed the line with? Do you need the mercy of God in a fresh way? This is Good Friday, and that's why it's good, because it causes us to face, oh, not false guilt, but true guilt, and be attuned to it once and for all. And so at the cross then, his justice and his mercy collide with our stiff necks, and as a result, our guilty verdict is wiped away. We are no longer called stiff-necked. We are no longer called resistant, but we are called righteous. True guilt has no power over us. And that is why Good Friday is a reminder for us to lead ourselves to the cross, but to lead each other to the cross as well. Not just on Good Friday, but every day. That is the place, because the cross reconciles. The cross reconciles races. The cross reconciles classes. The cross reconciles genders. And so facing true guilt requires divine assistance. And the cross is all about divine assistance. True guilt is acknowledging wrongdoing. And the correct feeling is remorse, not guilt. And not shame. And so, why? Why all of this? Why does God go to these great lengths? Because it's all about relationship. The guilt is a huge barrier between us and him in the relationship. And he wants us for relationship. He wants us to be his sons and his daughters. He wants us to be his people. He wants to be our God. He wants to be our Father. And so the cross then is his initiative to deal with any barrier that is in the way of that relationship. Anything that inhibits, the cross takes care of. In fact, the cross is really, in terms of the why question, the cross is really a fulfillment of an ancient oath that God made to Abraham, much like the childhood pledge that probably you and I made with our BFFs when we were little. You know the statement? Cross my heart and hope to die, stick a needle in my eye. Have you ever said that? And the promise was, I will die. I'm going to hurt myself. I'm going to do anything it takes so that I am faithful and loyal in the relationship and in the friendship. And so the cross is loyalty personified. The only match for our relentless, ongoing, escalating guilt and our inability to admit that guilt is God's relentless, matchless love. Let me say that again. The only match for our relentless, ongoing guilt is God's relentless, ongoing loyalty and love. And so it's like the song goes. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, and I say relentless love of God. I prefer relentless instead of reckless. And so the cross is a picture of God chasing us down. It's the great pursuit. The cross again, referring to the words of the song, it's a picture of God fighting for us till we are found. The cross is a picture of God climbing Mount Calvary, because no mountain he won't climb coming after me. We would be fools to resist this love. Some still do, out of stiff-neckedness. We need God's assistance, and Good Friday and the cross reminds us of that. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, relentless love of God. Indeed, as Paul says, as a result of this love, as a result of our relationship now that is at peace with God, here is the good news of Good Friday continued, that nothing in all creation can separate us from that loyal love. And he has a whole list of things in Romans 8. Neither death nor life, neither tribulation, neither sufferings can separate us from this loyal love. And so, who can bring a charge against you today, this Good Friday? No one. Who is there to condemn you? No one.
Can we acknowledge the reality of our guilt? Donna said that our sinful guilt is a fact, not a feeling. The only right response is to acknowledge it and then respond with spirit-inspired remorse. Guilt and the emotions that we might try to conjure up, those aren't feelings that we can manufacture, but godly sorrow, godly remorse is deep. It's from God, and it's followed by a lifestyle change. It's followed by repentance. Donna said, the cross reminds us to admit guilt and its consequences. It reminds us to admit guilt, that second criminal and his response. By his death, Jesus offers divine assistance. And he offers us beautiful forgiveness and right justice. I want to lead us to reflect on a question this evening, just one question, but to take a minute to respond in silence. And the question is, in which ways are we still living as a stiff-necked people? In which ways are we still living resistant to the gospel? Take a minute to reflect on that and answer it, each of us, for ourselves. As the forgiven people of God by faith, let's pray together now. Jesus, you paid the penalty for our sin, and the hope of the gospel is that by faith, we who were once resistant have been made righteous. No one can condemn us, not even ourselves. May we receive your forgiveness. And may we no longer live in our old identities, but instead now as the beloved sons and daughters of God. Jesus, we love you And we thank you for your sacrifice on the cross and its reality for the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
For the love our God has shown. broken and scattered, mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed, but not forsaken, I've been set free, I've been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see now. See the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Take our weakness and set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saves.
The the death of Jesus, Luke 23, verse 44 to 47. It was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, where the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. Now when the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God, saying, "Certainly this man was innocent."
Light of the world by darkness slain.